Oh, shit. Thanks for coming out. All right, music time. Thank you. Thanks a lot, guys. I am going to bring up the homie Ken Susie. He works with Fishman.
How you guys doing?
Also shreds in a band called Unearth. I don't know if you guys are.
Thank you.
So he knows a thing or two about guitar.
Guys, thank you very much. I'd like to thank, on behalf of Fishman, I do play in a band called Unearth. My name's Ken Susie. I'm also the product manager at Fishman, and I'm also the artist relations guy. On behalf of the company, seriously, I'd really like to thank all of you guys for coming out and supporting this new venture for us with that's, you know, electric guitar pickups in general. As you guys know, we're mainly acoustic company, so now we're venturing to this new, you know, unexplored territory for us, but we're lucky enough to have a talent like Tosin Abasi playing our pickup. So thank you guys very much for showing up to this event. Thank you. So, Tosin's, we're basically, the way I'm going to MC the event, we're going to do a little Q&A with Tosin, and then after we're done doing that, we're going to open up the conversation for you guys to ask Tosin also questions as well. I'd also like to introduce another person that's going to be on the panel tonight. This is Frank Falbo. He's a Chicago native. He's a guitar builder. He's also on the development team as far as like how we actually make these pickups, voicings, you know, and he's a very integral part of actually being a part of the team. So, Frank Falbo.
No.
So, I guess we'll just hop into it. I guess one of the things, I was endorsed by Ibanez Guitars for many years, and I think they're a great company. Tosin's guitar, and I want to ask you, Tosin, I mean, this is a really unique design for Ibanez. Everyone knows the RG, everyone knows the Gems, the Universes, the S-Series. I mean, they're incredibly well-thought-out company. They're always great and on top of their designs. But this guitar is unlike any other guitar that Ibanez has ever made, and I just wanted you to kind of give everybody an explanation as to why you chose the design, what's in it, like what is this guitar, you know, and what does it mean to you?
Okay. I was playing Ibanez, and I was using the existing models they had. It was based off of the RG, and my first attempt at a signature guitar was limited by the fact that I had to work in the RG sort of framework, and so I focused on, you know, the finish and voiced my own pickups at the time for it, and it is what it is, but I actually got them to allow me to design something from the ground up, and the result is this. This is actually a prototype. It's like one of the first ones they made. I don't know if in the back you can see it, but at some point tonight, I'll let you guys like handle it if you want. yeah, in an orderly fashion. I basically, even though I play Ibanez, I had a lot of custom-made like ergonomic-inspired designs from various luthiers, and some of the concepts were cool, and I wasn't seeing them in Ibanez guitars, so I tried to integrate some of the design concepts that I thought would be cool in an 8-string. One thing I noticed is that the footprint of an 8-string guitar is quite large. If you're used to a 6 or 7, and you get on the 8, it feels like you're playing on a surfboard or something like that. Like, so I ended up narrowing the string spacing, which, you know, multiplied by 8 actually made a noticeable difference in the overall width of the fretboard. So the string spacing is, you know, noticeably more narrow, not in a way that hinders you, but in a way that makes the neck feel more manageable. Another thing I did was to utilize the compound scale or fan fret approach, because the guitar and the bass are obviously different instruments. The guitar scale length is usually, the sweet spot seems to be around like 25 and a half inch, anywhere from 24.7 to 25 and a half inches. That's what your classic sort of guitar designs are like a Fender or like a Gibson. And I think that feels and sounds great for the treble strings, but the lower you get, the longer neck you need. That's why bass guitars have really long necks, upwards of 30 inches, 30. So the idea with the compound scale is that you are actually combining two scale lengths at their longest points, shortest and longest points. So here you'd have 25 and a half inches, and here you have 27 inches. So it makes the string tension of your lowest strings appropriate for the tuning, and then it keeps the treble strings in that sweet spot. So when you bend and do vibrato, it doesn't feel like crazy because your scale is super long. So that was a big innovation. Conceptually or aesthetically, I definitely wanted to do something that looked like modern. So that's where the shape comes from. I always liked single cut guitars for some reason, and there weren't many extended range ones that I saw, so yeah, I decided to do that. And then the Fishman Fluences would be the final step, and I think what makes this guitar really special, because they sound so good. They're really versatile. I mean, for what I want out of a high gain extended range pickup, I wasn't finding many pickups that did that. It's like when you have a high gain humbucker, you kind of are unable to get like really chimey cleans, or it might not split as musically as you'd want it to. The Fluences, the way they're designed, they really escape a lot of those limitations as far as the engineering of the pickup is concerned. So it was really awesome to find that this kind of like the Fluences were the final addition to this guitar, and it really, like, for me, made it feel like it was something special and something modern and something really versatile. So yeah, that's this guitar in a nutshell.
So what's so everyone I'm sure is wondering, when is this guitar set to be released?
Yeah.
That's the question.
I think it's, I don't know if I'm allowed to say, it's coming.
There you go, exactly. Oh, yeah. All right, so since you were actually just talking about Fishman Fluence pickups, I guess the thing is a lot of you people are probably new to the technology. You guys are probably heard of the Fluence pickups, but don't necessarily know exactly what they're about. So you've tried every single pickup that there is. I mean, you were with EMG. I think you were with Duncan for a short time.
Duncan DiMarzio.
So you've tried
Bare Knuckle.
Yeah, so you've tried just about everything. How did you arrive? How did you find out about Fishman? Like, tell us your journey and how you got there.
Well, I was working with, at the time, I was working with Seymour Duncan. My friend Keith Merrill was over there, and I liked what he was doing with extended range pickups. And I was a passive pickup guy, so I was like, cool, I'll just go with like the largest passive pickup company. And I got a sound that I thought was cool, and I knew of the Fishmans, but I was like really skeptical, because I was like, I mean, look, everyone claims to be able to do shit that hasn't been done before, and most guitar players are like, I'll just use what like Eric Clapton used, that's fine. It was good enough for him or something, you know what I mean? Like, we don't want anything new. Like, so I'm not that rigid, but I definitely was just like, oh, cool, acoustic guitar company's making pickups now, and they want me to try them. It was like, eh. So, which is like, you know, it is what it is. But then one day, Frank, who's a Fishman engineer and a guitar builder himself, was over in my studio. I think we were talking about you were going to make me a 7-string acoustic guitar.
It's an 8-string.
Is it an 8-string?
Fan fret, yeah.
Oh, sick.
Change the specs now in front of everybody.
And so he was like, dude, you should just try these pickups real quick. And I had already been playing this guitar with my, like, what would have been my next signature set. And I just plug in this set of Fishman Moderns, and the difference was like so shocking that I literally had to just like abandon ship. That was the story. Literally, I did an A-B test without realizing it, and the difference was like enough for me to be like, man, I gotta play these things. That was before I even voiced my own set. So
just so you guys know too, as well, we're approaching electric guitar pickups completely different. I mean, we're using a 48-layer thinly sliced PCB versus a wound coil. Frank could probably tell you like the inner workings a little bit more in depth than me, but I mean, just when you wind a pickup, every single time you wind a pickup, it's pretty much different, depending on the wire, depending on how many turns, you know, what you're trying to achieve. Even if like a company, you know, company X says, make this pickup a million times, it's always going to sound different. Luckily with Fluence, and you can speak for yourself, but I'd say that every single time we give you a set of pickups, it's identical from one to the other, and they're multi-voiced, silent, you know, splitting. We can just about do anything. So it's this whole new concept. I like to consider it like, old tube televisions. You know, you used to have them in your house, but you don't really watch tube television anymore. It's like a high def. It's more of like a high def picture of what either a passive or active pickup's supposed to sound like. So,
wait, I have a question that many of you might be wanting to ask. How are these different from actives and passives?
Okay,
let's have Frank take it.
Yeah, that's a good one. So the core difference is in the core, okay? So what I like to say is, you know, every day we have advancements in technology, and so you get to this point where a brain surgeon can do something that they never could do before. Because technology advanced, now they got something going in there, there's microscopes and all this stuff, there's things that you can do. These coils, they came to me, an aerospace company, and said, we do this, we think you know, pickup technology can benefit from this. And I immediately saw the benefit, but what I say about these is that, you know, these are coils that I could never wind. I've been making pickups for a long time and designing pickups. There's no way to get here, these salient features, in any other way. You could give me $1 million and park me in front of a winding machine and tell me I could buy whatever I want. I can't turn that coil. So what Ken said about those 48 layers, right, top to bottom, it's hearing the string in a more phase-aligned way. And that lack of group delay, I'm going to get nerded out on you guys for a second, that lack of group delay and that phase coherency is like focusing a camera lens, right? And once it's focused, that's great. But I can never start with an image that is out of focus. I can't apply any EQ, compression, whatever. There's nothing I can do to it to bring focus back. So we're starting with something that's more in focus than any wound coil. From there, we can make it sound and behave like anything. I'm not talking about like a modeler. I'm talking about analog circuitry in there and designing a magnetic circuit so that this pickup can behave and sound and feel and do all the stuff that we want, but like that high-def version of it, right? You can always take a high-def TV and put a filter on it. It looks like that 1970s tube television. I can't go the other way. I can't start with a tube TV and make it high-def. So when this technology came to me, I was like, this has to get done. And, you know, to the point where I picked up my proverbial bags and brought this over to Larry Fishman, the place I knew that had the technology, the engineering department, the chops.
And let's just say he was at a company that makes pickups.
Before that.
Makes a lot of pickups.
Hey, you know, we do a lot of things.
Yeah.
Yeah, so when I tell you this is a pickup that can only be made this way, then, you know, there's some credibility there.
And we'll also talk about, as you know, we're probably gonna let Tosin probably play again, but we're gonna go in deeper as far as how we actually arrived here. But I think we can talk about, you know, want to play another song?
I don't know. Yeah, I mean, maybe let's talk a little bit more about.
Well, okay, so you tried the moderns, right? So before we even get to your signature model, you've tried other pickups on our line. We have a great obviously, we're surrounded by Les Pauls, right? Telecasters, Stratocasters. So what other pickups did you try that you inherently liked?
Well, the interesting thing is he's describing this new engineering technique, right? So you would imagine that it wouldn't sound guitar-like, or maybe there's a fear that because they aren't the same construction, then the end result would be different. What's interesting in talking about Les Pauls and Stratocasters is that the tones I wanted were very, like, you know, Fender sort of country cleans. I wanted a single coil sound, but I also wanted a, you know, a humbucker that could do all the high gain stuff, but I wanted a very real split coil or single coil sound. And I heard another Fishman artist, Greg Koch, I don't know if you guys have heard him play, but it's absolutely insane. And he's like a very classical, very traditional player when it comes to like rock guitar is concerned. And he's using these new, like, modern pickups. And the sounds, it's like Strat 2.0, or like the perfect, like you're just hearing the perfect Strat tones and the perfect Tele tones. It's hyper real, but like the characteristics are still the same. So there isn't this danger of losing what makes the guitar sound like a guitar just because the construction's different. It's literally, like you said, that focusing of the lens. It's correcting some, you know, technical limitations that existed in, you know, existing pickup technology. So for me, I definitely wanted that sort of spanky, clean, brilliant sort of percussive sound, and because you can voice these to have more than one voicing, it was easy to do all of it. They're also noiseless, and when you want to split the humbucking pickup, you can get a very real single coil sound that doesn't sound like kind of like a budget version of a single coil, you know?
To Tosin's point, also, if you pick up any guitar that's hanging on the wall here that has non-Fluence pickups, there's going to always be like a Strat, for instance, a 60 cycle hum that always exists there. If you plug in Fluence, I mean, you can turn the amp to 10, you can turn the pickups right on, open up the guitar, and it's dead quiet. And not to mention, you have two voicings, a Strat-style sound, and then you get something a little more muscular. Hey, something a little more muscular, like a Texas. Hey, feedback. Oh, okay, cool. All right, awesome. Well, now's a good time to play. You want to play something?
Well, I was just going to...
Yeah.
obviously, like, my signal chain is, I use a fractal, which is a digital modeler, so I don't want you guys to think that I'm running a ton of, like, secret stuff in there to make them sound the way they sound. So we've got a single channel Morgan head. It's just like a, it's just a clean head. There's not even a distortion channel. So I'm going to play through that just so you can hear the pickups as direct as possible. Pretty nice, you know, that's the second position, which is the two inner coils here. If I go here. That's my fourth position, which would be not parallel coils, but just one. So kind of like a true single coil sound. Super, I don't know an 8-string guitar that sounds like that, you know, like.
It doesn't exist.
They really do the. So you can even get that sort of like bass sort of sound. Yeah, and then, I mean, I guess for the fully humbucking sounds, you can do, I have two voices. They're pretty subtly different, but some of the other sets kind of have a dramatic difference between the two voicings. So see, there's a brighter. On the second voice, the low end kind of creeps in and opens up. So I rarely say this, but it's kind of like you're buying four pickups.
Yeah.
If you buy a set.
It's not like you're just adding, like, we took away treble off of the initial sound. It's actually like you're installing two sets of pickups inside of that one guitar, and it's on a push-pull or a push-push, two-way toggle, whatever it is.
So yeah, it's like not just a sonic difference. There's actually, because you know pickups have a feel too, right? Like, so it's more. It's not like there's like an EQ or like a preamp boost or some anything like that going on. It's literally like the pickup changes form, which is really great. And that's straight into the amp, you know. And we haven't even gotten to the high gain stuff. But I wanted you guys to know that you could plug it straight in, and actually the difference is arguably more noticeable. It has nothing to do with my signal chain or anything like that.
We'll be right back.
Thanks.
So guys, basically we're gonna go through the models real quick. This is a slash Les Paul with some classics in it. Frank's holding, these are our core products. We have a Stratocaster set, we have modern humbuckers, Telecaster, well, obviously Greg Cox signature tele set that we discussed. We have a really exciting thing going with some other artists as well, other than Tosin. We have Stephen Carpenter, 7 and 8 string humbuckers. We have Killswitch Engage. Both Joel and Adam are sharing a signature set because they have very similar likes. Willie Adler from Lamb of God. So we have a lot of exciting stuff with a lot of different players coming on board, and it's really a movement, and it's really great. So, Tosin, basically, what I want to move into is like, so you tried some pickups, you like them, but then we got to the point where you were sold, but we wanted to make you a signature pickup that was specific to you. I want to, like, and I know Frank, you and Frank worked very closely on these. I just want to discuss what the process was like and how we arrived at this particular set.
But I know there's some things I can't say about the process.
some of it's secret.
Okay, how many of you have had the privilege of voicing your own pickup with someone? Have any of you done it? You've done it. So you get a pickup, you're like, it's almost there, and then you take notes, and then they have to wind a completely new pickup. And the difference, if it's not swapping out a magnet, it's literally the amount of winds in the pickup, right? So it's like it can take forever because you have to mail it back, they make a new pickup, send it to you, you're like, yeah, almost. And then you make notes again, you send, then they revise it, This is not how I think anyone would craft a tone if they could do it differently, because the amount of time it takes, say a week later you listen to the pickup, you're like, I don't even, what did I want to change? So the Fishman process of voicing the pickup is as real time as making a tone on your amp. So you're literally you're literally dialing it in, and you can, and it's a real thing. It's not, relative to weeks and memory. And so, I've seen the process done where a friend of mine was doing it, and he had this amp, and he knows exactly how that rhythm patch sounds. And he knows what every pickup he's plugged into that particular sound sounds like. And so he was able to reference that in real time to exceed his favorite pickup, because he could literally A-B them and change anything he wanted. So the process for me was the same way you try gear and you try to get it into that sweet spot to do exactly what you want, I got to do that with pickups, which is no other company could do that unless they have the Fluence technology, because it's literally not how you make a normal pickup.
So Frank does a lot of the voicing along with Larry Fishman and our team of engineers. But Frank and Tosin sat very, for a session. I want to say, you've probably been a part of other sessions with other companies where it's taken months and weeks. And, I think you guys did this in a short period of time, right?
How long was it? An hour or two? Because when something sounds good, you don't have to, labor over it, first of all.
Here's the basic thing. Obviously, I want to clarify. We're not talking about I fly to your house and voice pickups, right? You get to benefit from the pickups that Tosin has voiced. But, because the coil is so perfect and so pure, the one thing that you can't overcome is the magnetic circuit. So the way the magnets interface with the string, that you have to sort of decide that up front. Now, we played around with a couple of different things, but Tosin says to me, he goes, I got this one tele neck pickup. It's amazing. Can you do that? And I'll tell you, one of the best, most rewarding parts of what I'm doing here is I get to say, yes, I can. And so we made this pickup for him where the neck side of the neck pickup has Alnico pole pieces like a Strat or a Tele would have. But then the other coil's got a blade in it, and then this one's a ceramic and it's steel blade. So once I get that dialed in, then, it's as easy as me tweaking things in real time. And there's so many times you don't realize, until you do it, you don't realize, you're like, wait, I think I wanted a little bit more treble. And then you're like, but if I put it right here, you're like, wait, no, that's not right, because my amp doesn't like that. So we're able to overcome so many things by and also having them disconnected, which means that I can do something to the high end and it has zero effect on anything else. If I'm winding a pickup and I gotta go from here to here, someone goes, hey, it's like this, but I want it like this. Then I can say, well, okay, I'm gonna do this, but here's three other bad things that are gonna happen when I do it. And I gotta overcome those with some other method.
Is it like those prescription pills that like fix one thing?
Yes, they have side effects. Yeah. I like this pickup. Yeah, I want it to sound a little sweeter. Well, that's fine, but you might start growing some warts on your toes. You know. And if we don't want that, then we're gonna move to this technology. But so yeah, it's a lot of fun. There's actually really, when you break it down, there's three voices inside Tosin's pickups because that single coil voice is a third voice. So that's pretty amazing. The way he has it wired and set up, there's some automatic things that are happening on his five-way, but if you put it into a guitar and maybe you didn't want to have the super five-way or had a bunch of toggle switches or whatever, you can even access more sounds than even Tosin is getting right now out of his setup. But his setup is exactly how he, you know, how he wants it.
I didn't know that.
Well, we'll talk later.
You're talking to the guy. So show everybody a little bit what the single coil sounds like again, just to remind everybody.
I guess we would do it like maybe with a distorted setting. So here's like the voice one on the humbucker. So that one's girthier. It's less bright. And yeah, it's genty, and it's got, I like how the low end opens up like that. I said it. And then, so if I go to the second set, so that's nice. That's one of my favorites, actually. Obviously, in the middle, you can blend both humbuckers the way I have it set up. I rarely use that setting, the two humbuckers at once. It's just not really happening lately. But then the fourth position. It kind of has that sort of Strat sort of vibe. And then the neck humbucker.
The response of the pickup, I mean, would you say, how would you characterize the response, like the quickness coming from your hand to the amp? You know what I mean? Do you see that being, because sometimes when you play pickups, they all feel differently. I think they hit the amp differently. With Fluence, what have you really noticed as far as how the quickness?
Well, mine are, they speak really like instantaneously. So I feel like they're like hyper responsive. I played a set of the classics in that Les Paul, and that was definitely like a bit saggier, but it still had the Fluence thing, which was cool. But it had a little bit more give, you know? But I like the immediacy of the note arrival. So my pickups kind of, they're really dialed to just like shoot out frequencies really fast, because I need that articulation. I feel like in a mix, you would normally like maybe add compression and you try to like EQ it to get that subtlety and that rapid response. But it's great that with these pickups, you're closer to that point without needing to tweak, you know what I mean?
Yeah. No, and it's funny that you said that, like even with a guy like Devin Townsend, who also has sort of a hybrid magnetic circuit in his pickup, for him, we had to do something in the bridge pickup to put in a little bit of that sag in one of the voices because it's the thing that he was used to. But that's the beauty, is we can. I can do that, and then I can have it not there for the other voice, because we've been touching on it all night, but none of these voices are related to one another. So the coil itself hears the most perfect sound from the string that it can possibly hear. It's like extracting colors out of white light. I have everything, and I have it very dense. I don't have any comb filtering or any of that from the group delays. So it's like I'm starting with everything, and then I can just decide what I'm going to listen to, what I'm going to let pass through. And then, of course, the preamps are integrated in with the coil, like the voicing. So everything's sort of like living and breathing together and resonating together, instead of like you said, like just some pickup and then an EQ pedal on the floor. Mm. you know, that you change around. So, you know, that affects the feel. I mean, that's why coming off of your fingers, it's got this more alive feel than probably any other humbucker you've ever played.
Absolutely. And, I mean, they've got a lot of great amps here. And if you plug into something like a Morgan that's got a really high-quality transformer and it's just, like, point-to-point wired, it, like, shows you what response can be like. And we buy amps like that because they're so responsive. And then these pickups are just, like, one further step in that direction of immediacy. Do you know what I mean? So it's definitely worth plugging in and messing around because you can decide for yourself, you know?
Yeah. So one other thing, too, is that all of our pickups are technically need to be powered. So some of you guys that are picking up Strats or Tellys or a Tosin set will be like, well, I don't really like to put a battery in my guitar. You know, a 9-volt, it dies. It's not true to the guitar. But we Fishman Fluence made a whole line of battery packs. We have this thing that we like to call smart power. So it gives you a consistent 9 volts for like 230 or 200 plus hours, whatever it is, depending on the setup pickup and the configuration. So me personally, I'm on stage, and I'm playing in front of like thousands of people. I'm saying to myself, I used to think, oh, is my 9 volt going to die? You know what I mean? Like I can't remember the last time I changed it. Did my tech do it? I actually play for months on end, you know, and just don't ever charge my guitar. And then there's a small little light indicator that lets you know when it's time to charge your guitar, and you have like 10 hours from that point. So it's actually kind of cool. You forget the whole concept of batteries. You just kind of put in your guitar and let it go.
Also, this aversion to having a battery in your guitar is not based on anything. So if you feel that way, realize it's irrational.
Well, yeah. I mean, I like to tell people, too, you know, the very, very first thing your guitar hits on the other end of that cable turns it into a buffered pickup. I mean, it's an active sound at that second, right? Now, we all know, you know, sometimes you want to have a passive guitar right into a germanium fuzz with an 8-volt battery in it or whatever. So, I mean, we're not trying to recreate, you know, any of those mythical recipes necessarily that half, well, you've got to have this thing and you got to have this coily cord and you have to have this thing. But, you know, they do a certain thing, and in order to do the thing, they require power. And Ken asked me, you know, before what the difference is between these pickups and certain passive pickups and then certain active pickups. One of the other distinct differences are that although this requires power to operate, the sound and feel that we've become accustomed to in hearing in a lot of other active pickups leading up to this point, meaning the kind of the same reason you left an active pickup, some of that has to do with the preamp clipping. It's a hard limit. And so even at 9 or even at 18 volts, a lot of the electronic circuitry inside those pickups will hit the limit hard. So you hit the strings, and you don't get all the dynamics that you would have gotten out of a passive pickup because of the limitations of the electronics. Now, I can go into all the other kind of details like coil loading and all the rest of these things that make them sound flat or dull or lifeless or this or that or the other thing. But the truth is there's a legitimate feel difference when you're playing into a preamp that's clipping. Our preamps don't do that. Like I said, they're more interacting with the coil in the same way that a passive pickup would interact. A passive pickup, if you hit your guitar with a sledgehammer, still can't rail out at 9 volts. So the fact that we're powering it with a consistent and even immediate 9 volts in the battery pack, or if it's drawing it from the 9-volt battery, means that it's going to feel the way you guys want them to feel.
Just think of it as, it's not active, it's just powered. So I guess what I want to ask you too, and I don't think we've ever talked about this, but I want to say that, like, how is it when you're touring? I mean, have you encountered anything that was different about these pickups? Like, did they break on you? You know what I mean? Like, consistency, you know, like, you know, I'm just saying, you got to say, have you had to switch out your guitar? Are they roadworthy? Like, how does
Yeah, no, work? I mean, I've toured extensively on these, and I haven't had any issues. Even with the battery life thing, like the ones I have at home, like I don't even think I've charged yet. And my tech will just plug it in like once a week just for the, because he needs to look like he's doing something. You know? No, but yeah, it's cool because with a normal active pickup, I think you'd have like, as the battery dies, so does your tone. So it's not fully dead. You'll be like, oh fuck, is it sounding thin? And you're playing this. These will just stop, like, because of that consistent 9-volt thing, right?
Yeah. If you use a 9-volt, it'll still brown out the 9, you know, at some point. If you use the battery pack, Like I said, it's smart power, which means it's going to deliver like a consistent 9 all the way up until the very end. It's going to extract 9 volts all the way until it can't do it anymore. And when that light starts blinking, you have it plugged in, the light's blinking at you, you know you like should plug in. Even if you plug in for 15 minutes between sound check and downbeat, you're charged up way beyond that, you know, what you need for that 3-4 nice. 5 hour set.
We charge our phones all the time.
Yeah. You know what I mean? Oh, and it's a USB charge too. So if you have that look, that blue stick you had backstage, yeah. if you have any battery like backup things that you do use for your phone, you can use the same ones to charge up the universal battery.
We all know battery is life at this point, right? Right. You always gotta be charged, just like now your guitar too.
So we're sitting here talking about you know, Fluence pickups in general, but another really cool thing, being a metal guy myself, you know, I'm not very integrated with the acoustic scene. So Tosin actually has been using some other Fishman products on stage that I think we should talk about. I mean, just tell us what you've been using and if you, you know, what about it that you like.
We have a few like songs with the nylon string guitar that we gotta play. And so I use the Loud Box, which is a Fishman acoustic amplifier. I use the Aura, which is a really cool sort of like convolution acoustic. I don't know, it's a very technical thingy.
Nailed it.
Yeah.
It basically, you know, you plug right into the Aura, and it almost it gives you the sound of a specific microphone that has been imaged, and it brings it right to the front house. So your guy at the front house, he doesn't have to put a microphone in front of his guitar or anything like that. He's getting a pure signal that just was recorded at Fishman, specific to that guitar, and they've run it right through the house, and it sounds amazing. It sounds studio quality, just like you would picture an Axe FX or a Kemper, but I think it's on another level where it sounds identical to an actual microphone, like a Neumann or whatever it is that you want to use. So it's a really cool product. It's definitely a cool product.
Cool. Should we take questions?
Yeah. You guys have any questions? I mean, we've been talking your ear off this whole time. Feel free to ask Tosin anything you want.
My favorite song to play? I like playing Inner Assassins. But I'm not gonna play it. Sorry. Yeah, well. Yeah, you got a question?
Okay. No. No, the question is whether you want to use a treble bleed if you're used to using that on passive pickups. No, these pickups don't need that at all. And that's actually what makes the Strats even and the Les Pauls like amazing, is that when you turn the volume down, not only is the taper great, but the sound doesn't change. We're just bringing the volume up and down. And so if you've ever listened to you do volume swells, but like Greg Cock will do this stuff too, even with the tone control, and he'll like use it like a wah pedal where he just wows it up and down. All the controls work amazingly right out of the gate. If what I've found, everybody might be different, is that if you're a guy who likes to play passive pickups without a treble bleed, you will love how this volume control reacts. If you're a passive guy that likes a treble bleed, you're still gonna love how this reacts, you know? So that's what I found. It sounds like a pitch, but it's not. It's like you just, that need is gone because that repair is unnecessary now, you know?
Yeah. Más preguntas? You have one? Someone transitioning from the 6-string to the 8-string world should transition to the 7-string world first. Yeah. I don't know, though. I think there are people who have just gone for it. But the incremental step is how I did it, just because 8-strings weren't around when I got the 7. And I got used to that, so adding one extra string wasn't that big of a deal. But I was talking about this earlier with the design of this guitar. There is this big physical difference. Depending on the brand of guitars you play, there might not be the same manufacturer making an 8-string. So then the neck profile will be different, the bridge will be different, the string spacing. So that's part of the reason I wanted to narrow the string spacing. It fits more comfortably in your hand, whether or not you're used to 8-strings. If you're used to 8, this feels like, whoa, really small. And if you're used to playing 6, it's not as like shocking of a difference. What are we playing? You have a question? Oh my God. This is like a loaded question.
No, like actual like picks, like
plectrums. Oh. I thought you were like, do I have a pick out of all the claims of being my number one fan? Yes. Are you my number one fan?
Definitely.
How can we empirically prove this, though?
I know. This seems like the right place to figure that out.
You know what I mean? You can have a pick either way, though.
I've seen you in concert like twice.
There are fans who've seen us way more times than that. You could still be number one, though. Yeah. You have a question over there? We'll do homie in the, yeah. Yeah. You still need one just because of the amount of gain that's gonna be in a high gain tone, but I have dirty power at home and it's kind of like this weird interference-y sort of vibe. And it happens a lot on the split coil sounds of all my other humbucking pickups, but on the Fluences it's quiet, which is cool, because their noise, the impedance, is it? What's the vibe? What is it?
All of the above. So it's a low impedance signal leaving the guitar, so it's less susceptible for noise. But even when, like in his one setting, there's only one coil on, so technically that should be like a single coil humming sound, and it's like quieter than a typical passive Alnico humbucker anyway, because these coils are so efficient. So they can be run as singles and be like really darn quiet.
Word. Did you have a question?
First little question. How do you feel when you see another black guy in your show?
Depends on how he's looking at me. I mean, it stokes me out. It's like progressive metal isn't necessarily the most diverse field of like music. This goes for gender too, because apparently only white guys want to listen to shred guitar. I mean, I don't know why it's like that, but I think in 2017 there's enough people making it and hearing it that it's just really dismantling the idea that it's just only for one person. So, yeah. So thanks for being black and being here. You too. Because I'm black and I would have been here either way. So it's like, fuck. Oh man. Yeah,
can you talk a little bit about what it's like kind of like
playing with our drummer?
Yeah.
It's cool. He likes to really obscure like where the downbeat is, so sometimes you actually have to ignore him. Which is ironic, you know. But yeah. He does clinks. You should go to one of his clinks and ask him what it's like to have the privilege of playing with me. No, I'm just kidding. We'll see what he says.
Yeah, he ignores my downbeat.
Yeah. Yeah. He's one of the most like dedicated musicians I've encountered. He still practices like it's day one, and yeah, he hasn't reached his final form yet, I don't think.
Yeah.
What? Nah, that's funny. I'll tell you what, the amount of things that I can't do on the guitar as well as most guitarists is really interesting, and like, you have to change your idea of better to like, essentially just being like, are you speaking through your instrument? Are you getting your ideas out? If that means you gotta play faster, then put some time in to play faster. If it means you need to know more about theory and harmony, do that. But you kinda have to be your own metric. Am I getting better? I think I'm getting better, but not in ways that are obvious. You know what I mean? Like, the fast stuff and all that stuff was like my first goals. Cause I'm like, oh, good guitarists can play fast. You know? And then now I'm less impressed with that and more impressed with like, what are they playing? You know, this is a cliche thing that older musicians always tell younger musicians. And I used to be like, man, you don't know how I'm not gonna slow down. You're old. That's why you're slow, is because you're old and you can't be fast anymore. But they were right the whole time. You have a question?
Speaking of slow, what do you like driving better, the Lamborghini or the Audi?
Oh. What's interesting is that Audi owns Lamborghini and so is responsible for both of those cars. But I found that the new Lamborghini Huracan was a bit sterile. They've said that, yeah. You can drive that thing, you can definitely go get coffee for the whole office and not spill any coffee, if you wanted to. This has nothing to do with pickup, so maybe we'll... you have a question?
Hey, I got here
kind of
late. I got three less balls, and I'm looking on a project, my Supreme. It sounds with the semi-hollow body. I'm looking for a pickup that's sort of when that kind of closes the gap in the tone. And makes it kind of bite a little bit harder. Just kind of a dead neutral pickup where it sounds nice and brilliant on the highs and a tight low end response.
Faubs,
yeah.
What do you think?
I would, like, it's so easy to just start with the classics. Classic humbucker neck and bridge, wire up the push-pull for the voices, and you're there.
Because I guess the classics is like a PAF.
Yeah, voice one is very PAF-ish, kind of Alnico 2, Seth Lover, underwound PAF in the neck, and then a little overwound in the bridge. And then, you know, voice two is kind of that hot rod voice. But yeah, even just straight up voice one is going to just make, it's going to let the guitar's voice speak, but at the same time hit the amp with a very full and balanced frequency response.
Just looking for a Tully Ellison chain kind of response.
Yeah, that's voice two.
Voice two?
Yep, yeah. In the classics, you pull up, voice two, there.
And you're in luck, they have them here, 15% off.
One question over here?
Yeah, cool. So he's asking about delay and kind of getting like really ambient tones. I got a lot going. Like my Holdsworth setting, which I call Toldsworth. You want a really diffused delay that doesn't have like percussive repeats. Right. And blending it with reverb is really the vibe, like a cavernous reverb with like 5 seconds of like, you know, sustain, 5-6 seconds.
Okay.
Yeah.
And also, I'm sorry. It also has like a theatrical sound that I love a lot about it. And I'm just like, at times, like when you're playing live or whatnot and you have that theatrical tone, does it like get in the way or you just like, does it just enhance your tone?
A lot of these songs were built around the fact that certain parts had this big ambient delay, so it is what it is. I will say that the Strymon Big Sky reverb pedal is my favorite reverb pedal, and I'm basically just trying to copy that when I'm using the Fractal. So if you like reverb, plug into one of these things, because it's... I wish we recorded with it, like the depth, and like it's a big deal. That's your pedal.
I don't think it's 15% off, though.
It's not. They don't pay me. They don't pay you guys. You will pay for it.
Yeah.
It's worth it. It's really, really worth it. Yeah. So and it's pretty, too. It's over here. Yeah. You have a question? Okay. Any, what moments? So I did a tour called Generation X with Steve Vai and Yngwie Malmsteen and Nuno Bettencourt and Zakk Wylde. And I realized that I was just like a visitor in like this strange guitar hero world where like they had decades of like, it's like, oh yeah, when Ozzy was on the sauce and he came into the dressing room. And I was like, I was 5 years old when that happened. That's cool. Like... You know, or like, yeah, singing like an Yngwie like world tour shirt, and it's like I was 1 year old when that, you know, and these dudes are like monstrous personalities. So that's the part I wasn't like really aware of. I knew the playing would be like insane, but they're not normal people. They need a show, like they need a show. It's insane. Yeah, endlessly entertaining, and like they're all dads now, and. It's cool. It's cool to, like, I mean, guitar is in a different place right now, I think. Like, I think guitar rock doesn't really do arenas in the same way it used to. Like, everything from digital modelers to, like, streaming has just impacted just what it means to play guitar. But in a weird way, there's, like, this renaissance of love of guitar because, like, people in Kazakhstan can now, like, you know, download some software and, like, upload a sick... You know what I mean? There's the... So I feel like it was really cool to not really go back in time, but to really be around them and hear, like, these bits and pieces of what it was like when things were different. You know, I mean, touring with David Lee Roth, or when Vi was touring with him, or Whitesnake, or any range of really cool, like, rock history stuff, and who influenced them, that was a big deal, too. They're, like, talking about Deep Purple and all that kind of stuff, and I'm just like, I don't know that song, man. You know? But, like... They're just like, are you kidding? And then they're forcing me to listen to all this. So it was cool. It was like a serious guitar hang, actually. Yeah, yeah. All right. Should we? I'm using D'Addario NYXL strings. They're sick. Yo, I think I have 9.5 gauge strings on this. Just because I can. Yeah, they make a 9.5. And it's cool because of the, well, you know, the fan fretting. I was just like, I wonder if, like, because when you add length to a neck, you add string tension. So 9s can feel like 10s if you throw them on, like, a 27-inch neck versus, like, a 25.5-inch neck. So I was kind of like, I want a little bit more tension, and I don't want to gauge up completely. So, yeah, NYXL, dude. The lowest string, I'm not sure. I think this is a 72, or it's a 74, I think. I'm not super particular, and then once you get a guitar tech, you kind of just forget how to even, you don't even know what's going on with your own guitar.
There's one dude in the back that says that up the whole time.
Dude in the back. Yeah, there's a local guy. He's from either Chicago or, like, a suburb nearby named Isaiah Sharkey. And, God. What's that? Really? Damn. I wish he was my guitar teacher. Isaiah's recently been touring with John Mayer, but he was also on that latest D'Angelo record. It's just like if you heard a church organist mixed with, like, early George Benson shred, and you're just like, I didn't even know that many chords even existed, and it, why does it sound like a gospel vocalist is also singing through your, I mean, it really is this amazing musical space that he's been able to create. And I used to really, like, avoid really traditional guitar playing and players, because I was like, well, I'm not going to be Stevie Ray Vaughan, so why am I going to try? As inspiring as a lot of that stuff was, I was really chasing, like, I'm like, well, Holdsworth sounds weird. Like, I don't know, I was really stimulated by what I considered, like, was forward-thinking new sounds. But the older I get, the more I appreciate some of the more traditional electric guitar sounds, like mid-gain breakup on a Strat.
Oh, yeah.
How do you can't beat it. It's like a food you never get tired of eating.
Yeah.
And you eat a lot, too. So Sharkey is really coming from that tradition of, like, B.B. King, George Benson, Joe Pass. But then where he really takes off is that sort of, like, diatonic chord work that you hear in a lot of gospel sort of playing. So, yeah, that dude's stoking me out. And then, but then there's other dudes who sound nothing like that I'm into. You said jazz? Yeah, jazz. So Adam Rogers and Jonathan Kreisberg and Kurt Rosenwinkel, they're almost like prog jazz, like, because they're not doing, like, you know, like, the shit is really, like, mind-bending harmony, and they got chops. So, yeah, those are dudes who really, like, they do things very differently than me, but I'm still extremely, like, inspired by what I'm hearing. What's that? Monobody?
You should.
Really?
Yeah.
Now I'm learning.
That's weird.
Monobody.
With
Yeah. Cool. All right, maybe I'll do one more question and then like a song.
Yeah.
Damn.
And my question for you is, as a guitarist going to a music school, was it difficult for you to like fit in there? Not fit in so much as like friends, but fit in as in like musically. Because it's so awkward because you used to be, you're self-taught, right?
Yeah.
Same, right? And it's like, it was incredibly difficult for me to understand like the first year or two. Did you experience that at all?
I experienced a lot. Okay, so she's asking about going to music school and was it like hard to like kind of fit in like as a guitarist. All right, first thing is I was the only dude with more than 6 strings on his guitar and the teachers would just make fun of me. It's kind of like the guy who's got the pickup truck with the huge tires and then the truck is lifted and it's got like loud exhaust. They think you're like, you can't play so you bought a bunch of like crap. You know what I mean? So it was, I had to like, yeah, it was kind of annoying. I was like, I'm up there playing like Johnny B. Good and like annoying rock performance tunes on this like 7-string guitar. So I actually got in trouble for not playing appropriately, but like I never wanted to sound like any like Chuck Berry, any of that stuff. So music school can sometimes try to force every musician through the same sort of process of development, irrespective of what your musical goals are. So that's tough. So you have to acknowledge, like, you're not going to want to do 100% of the stuff there, but you're there. So really focus on the stuff you like. Maybe acknowledge that you might learn something from something you think you didn't like, and then realize that it's a finite period of time and that it will be over. So if you really hate, you know, I don't know, country or something, and you're for, you know. But the other thing is, yeah, the whole you play too fast thing was, like, kind of a thing, too. They weren't really there for me like that. They're like, cute 10-string guitar, dude. What are you gonna have next week, you know? And I'm like, okay, well, we'll see.
yeah, a gig.
Yeah. The other crazy thing is that, I'll never forget this, I was in a class, and the whole idea is to like create working musicians, so you're paying money to learn. I went to a school that wasn't like a university. Their accreditation was based off of, in part, like job placement. So they needed to show that they were like producing musicians who like could be employed. And the whole idea is like, you gotta get a corporate gig. Cause like, you play some like Matchbox 20 songs for some company's like anniversary party, right? But they pay well. So their whole thing was like, you gotta learn to sight read and you gotta be versatile and cause you want a corporate gig. And I was like, they're like, well, what do you want to do? I was like, I want to be someone's favorite guitar player, and I want to play my own music around the world. They're like, yeah, that's cute. Everyone wants to do that, but what are you really going to do? And I was just like, I'm going to do that. And now I'm doing it, and you're all here, and it's amazing.